Greetings. The central, and I mean central, event in human history is the coming of God in the flesh to die as the sacrifice for mankind. It is so central, in fact, that the two largest religions on earth tell the story differently. In fact, almost completely in opposition to each other. In one religion, it is truly the central reason for the entire religion. In the other religion, it is a side comment, mentioned once with no verifiable detail. If you call yourself Muslim, I'd like you to examine this with me and ask, which of these two stories is more consistent, more coherent, and more believable? Of course, these two large religions are Christianity, even named after the one crucified and raised from the dead, proving he is God. The other is Islam, which claims Jesus was the Messiah, but was nothing special, beyond being a man, and was never crucified nor killed. Let's examine their two stories together, brother, and you can see if I honestly and accurately represent Islam's stories. Surah 4, 157a, the first half. And their boast, "Behold, we have slain the Christ Jesus, son of Mary, who claimed to be an apostle of God." I could pick this apart, but the meat of the error is in the next bit. However, they did not slay him, and neither did they crucify him. Point one, they did not slay or kill him, meaning Jesus. Point two, and neither did they crucify him, thus creating an incoherent distinction between death and crucifixion without death. To clarify, this denies the crucifixion and death on the cross. So what happened then? What story does Islam tell to explain the real happening? But it only seemed to them as if it had been so. It only seemed like those things happened. Let's look at more translations to get a fuller rendering. The Pickthall, "But it appeared so unto them." The Shakir, "But it appeared to them so like Issa." The Yusuf Ali, "But so it was made to appear to them." Made to appear requires an active agent, Allah. Dr. Bakhtiar, "Rather, a likeness to him of another was shown to them." Wahiduddin, "But it only seemed to them," and a translator comment, "as if it had been so." T.B. Irving, "Even though it seemed so to them." Al-Muntakab, "But they thought they did." See introduction. That's something special when the translator note is too big to insert. See introduction. The Abdel Hadin, "Though it was made to appear like that to them." I think you get the point. The Islamic story simply claims no one there actually knew what happened. Not the disciples, not the Jewish leaders, and not the Romans intent on killing him. Islam imagines that Allah made a false appearance. Things were not as they really appeared to be. And I want you to focus on Islam's dependence on the words appeared and seemed. Appearance indicates involvement of only the sense of vision. Seemed indicates no particular sense, but a perception of the sense or senses involved. The fact Arabic and Islamic scholars cannot agree on this salient point makes one wonder about the actual meaning. Many ascribe direct and active involvement by Allah. a willful act of deception against all witnesses. What story does Islam tell to explain the real happening? An intentional illusion, a deception by Allah. And that is Islam's story summed up in a sentence. We could look at the Bible's accounts. And I say accounts because volume and consistency matters. For the sake of this video, I will only mention actual crucifixion details. I will not cover 1. Messiah's death was foretold by the prophets. 2. Details of Messiah's suffering and the manner of death were revealed. 3. Jesus foretold his own death. And 4. Jesus confirmed the scriptures after his resurrection. These will make great videos, however. But for this video, brother, let's just look at a passage directly documenting the crucifixion. That process began with the Jewish leaders who had Jesus. In fact, Judas, who knew Jesus, betrayed Jesus to them. So you cannot claim they started with the wrong man. Luke 22:47, while he was still speaking, a crowd arrived, led by the man called Judas, one of the 12. He approached Jesus to kiss him. Judas knew who Jesus was and approached Jesus. And Jesus said to him, Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss? Judas approached Jesus, and Jesus spoke, knowing what Judas was doing. So we know Judas identified Jesus, not someone else. Then Jesus said to the chief priests, temple officers, and elders who had come for him, have you come out with swords and clubs as you would against an outlaw? Every day I was with you in the temple courts, and you did not lay a hand on me. But this hour belongs to you and to the power of darkness. Jesus speaks and confirms who he is. I was with you. Then they seized Jesus, led him away, and took him into the house of the high priest, and Peter followed at a distance. They physically grabbed Jesus. They seized him. There was no doubt they had Jesus. And later, in Luke 22:61, and the Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word the Lord had spoken to him, before the rooster crows today, you will deny me 3 times. Peter was close enough, the Lord could simply turn and look at Peter. Now, the men who were holding Jesus in custody were mocking him and beating him. Islam would have you believe the punches were imaginary. The men beat the air, beat an appearance of a man. Does that make any sense to you, brother? At daybreak, the council of the elders of the people, both the chief priests and scribes, met together. They led Jesus into their council and said, they have Jesus. They know they have Jesus, and they led Jesus to be interrogated. If you are the Christ, tell us. But he said to them, if I tell you, you will not believe. Islam would have you believe this whole scene is mass hallucination. Jesus was not there, only an appearance that seemed to talk to them. After these events, this same Jesus was sent to Herod for questions because Jesus was a Galilean. Luke 23:7. And when he learned that he belonged to Herod's jurisdiction, he, Mrs. Pontius Pilate, sent him, Jesus, over to Herod, who was himself in Jerusalem at that time. More questions and custody was maintained the whole way. But they were urgent, asking for loud voices for him to be crucified, and their voices were prevailing, and Pilate pronounced sentence that their demand be granted. A great number of people followed him, meaning Jesus, including women who kept mourning and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children." The Bible record continues to identify Jesus and record his speech. Is it believable that every case is an auditory hallucination? Can we believe no one knew what Jesus sounded like, as Islam would claim? And then even more details of Jesus talking to others. And two other criminals also were being led away to be put to death with him. And Jesus was saying over and over again, Jesus talks, and his message was consistent with who he was. "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." And they, the soldiers, cast lots, dividing his garments. This was after he was crucified, after he was nailed to the cross. The invention of Islam is that none of this ever happened. None of it. However, they did not slay him, and neither did they crucify him. How ludicrous is that claim? A man 600 years later and 800 miles away just says, "Nuh-huh." And a billion people swallow the claim without ever using a thought. The other two crucified men argued, and one of the criminals, having been hanged, were railing at him, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." Was this man also imaginary? Or did Allah deceive him so he was mocking an empty image? And the other, answering, was rebuking him, saying, "Do you not even fear God that you are under the same judgment? Here is a dying man accepting his punishment, honoring God in his last moments. We are punished justly, for we are receiving what we deserve for our actions. But this man has done nothing wrong." And he was saying, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Now, brother, I want you to honestly think about this. The thief on the cross asks Jesus to remember him kindly. And Jesus, on the cross, makes the man a promise. But if all this is a deception by your Allah, if Jesus is not on the cross as Muhammad claimed, if nothing is on the cross and the man is hearing an imaginary voice from Allah, Allah is one very sick and sadistic bastard. The only words that come to mind are too vile to say. Now, the point of this video, brother, is to compare the stories. The Bible records detail after detail after detail. The details are consistent. The details include many conversations with Jesus. Conversations with coherent dialogue. And the only thing Muhammad can conjure and invent is, "Nuh-huh, didn't happen. It only seemed to appear as if it did." No rational, sane person would buy Islam's story. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.